Hi everyone, and welcome to video number one of this two video mini series on the singular value decomposition. So what's the reason for this short video interlude, let's say? What we've seen until now about linear systems is that we have a lot of techniques, also linear techniques for other dynamical systems that help us to identify coefficients or the dynamical system itself. We have also seen that there are quite a few limitations in terms of nonlinear problems, right? Where linear methods tend to reach their limits. And this is one aspect that we would like to extend on here, that despite linear methods having their limitations, we can still do all sorts of cool things, such as dimensionality reduction. And this is what these two videos are about. And we will see later on that this is actually very, very important for feature extraction or as a pre-processing step for other types of algorithms. So what this is about is the question that we have a system of high dimension or potentially very high dimension, right? Or state X is in Rn and n is large. Right? This can be 100, this can be even a million or a billion, depending on which kind of system we want to study. We have seen for partial differential equations, we can easily get to the hundreds of thousands or even millions if we have a fine discretization. So what we want to study here is a reduction. And we start with the question, if we have so many of these states, do we really need all of them? Sorry, really need all the Xi. Okay, so we have talked about fluid flows, for instance, or other distributed systems where you can think of the situation that a particular pixel or one single measurement might not be particularly relevant for the overall system. Okay, and so this is the next question that is really related. Are these measurements uncorrelated? Okay, so the question is there really no relation between two points in my state space or two components of my state, or are they maybe in a sense related? And so these two questions are the motivating beginning statement to study how to make systems smaller in dimension and find maybe more related states. And to do so, let's have a short look at some code. Here's a rather large comment. You can check this out in the GitHub repository. What we've done is we have downloaded C surface temperature data that is publicly available, right? So here's the instruction how to download it. And then there's some code on pre-processing, which doesn't matter here. What's really important is that we get this statement here or these data. We have the longitudinal coordinate, we have the latitudinal coordinate, and we have this SST matrix, which is our data matrix consisting of sea surface temperature measurements at distinct point in time. So if we do this, now here you see the dimensions. So we have a 43,799 dimensional state, which means this number of measurements in space. And we have 120 snapshots. So this is the value I've chosen myself. So I want to study for 10 years the sea surface temperature distribution. And here's what it looks like. For instance, in December 22, and you see where light colors refer to warmer temperatures and more purplish colors to colder ones. So we see what can be expected, right? And what you can also see is that you can study the same temperature distribution at another point in time. So this is on the northern hemisphere, the summer, and you see, for instance, if you look at the Mediterranean Sea here, that the temperatures tend to be higher, or also here in the United States, you see here a difference in the temperature, meaning that, you know, during summertime, the temperature has shifted to the northern hemisphere. Okay, and now you see that this is a very large state space. So let's zoom in onto the South Pacific Ocean here, Japan, Korea, and so on. So this is what we see. This is just a zoom in of the one we had before, right? So you see Japan here, Korea, China, Thailand, and so on. And so you see that every pixel is a measurement, and we have roughly 48,000 of them. And so you can also imagine each individual of these pixels does not really carry a lot of information or meaning to us. And so the question whether we need all of them can be answered with no. And the question are they uncorrelated, can also be answered with no. Yes, you see, clearly there's a temperature gradient, a smooth gradient, so there tends to be some structure. We've seen large patterns of high temperature and large patterns of smaller temperature. So the question is really, can we find something that is tailored to a data set instead of saying, okay, I'm looking at sensor by sensor independently? Okay, and to do so, let's take a look back and go to a much, much simpler problem, namely the one that I've started sketching below here. And so my goal is going to be to tailor a basis and I'm going to call this U. So it's a bunch of vectors, U1 to UN to our data. Right, so this is a data matrix X, which has column-wise these snapshots, right? So I had these monthly temperature measurements. This would be each temperature measurement would be a column in this big matrix. So this was the SST matrix in the code, which had roughly 48,000 rows, right? Each entry for one sensor, and then 120 columns for each month, one column. Okay, and so what you see is this question of a relation. This can be studied easily in this very simple setting. Okay, so we see here a point cloud, and we can observe a very similar fact than in the code, that these seem to be correlated. Okay, and now if I take a look at a particular point, let's just take this one maybe, then we would see that you can express every point in terms of its basis, right? So this point would mean that this particular x has a dimension of 3 in terms of the first eigendirection and a value of roughly, let's say, 2 in the second component, right? So this would be something like 3 times the first unit vector plus 2 times the second unit vector. Or I can rewrite or explicitly write them out. So this would be 3 times 1, 0 plus 2 times 0, 1. And so you see, well, we need obviously both components to make a correct statement for the value of this point, that is 3 and 2, okay? But here's the thing, you see that there is some sort of correlation, and we know in linear algebra, we are not restricted to this coordinate system. We can simply do a change of basis, right? And so you see that there seems to be an elongation. And so let's just say, okay, why do we not pick a basis like this? Okay, so this is my U1. This is my vector U2. And now I can try to express this point, I guess it's not so well visible, in this new coordinate system. Okay, so now if I check this and I go into this direction, this might be a step of, it's a rough guess, let's say maybe 4. Okay, so the same thing would be 4 times, this is now a guess, but you see what I'm getting at, U1, and now we have to go down in the U2 direction, but only a little, let's say 0.5 maybe, okay? All right, so you've seen I've picked a basis that appears to be better suited to express the data, the point would be the same way, but the U1 component suddenly has a lot more meaning, and the U2 component seems to be less important. And this seems to be the case for all of these because, you know, the distance to this axis is rather small, where the variance in the U1 direction is a lot larger. And so what you can do now, if you do this, you can say, okay, the U2 direction is apparently not all that important if I want to get just a rough estimate, okay? And so this is what the singular value decomposition is all about. Okay, so this is the next statement. We may not care about all vectors. Right, so we don't care about all of them, but maybe just the R leading ones. Right? So let's just fix a number r and say, okay, we want to get only r of these vectors. And so this seems to be a challenging problem. How can we do this? And whenever we have no idea really how to do this, we can formalize it as an optimization problem, okay? So what I'm going to say now is I want to minimize over a bunch of vectors u1 to ur the error between my entire data point and the data point restricted to this r-dimensional subspace that is spanned by these leading r eigenvectors. Okay, so what I can do is, I would add something in a second, but let's say this is my point xi, and I want to compute or minimize the distance between ai and its restriction to this r-dimensional subspace. So what I'm going to do is, I'm going to say, give me the minimum between, say, j starting at 1 and going to r, the projection of xi onto the rth, the jth basis vector, and then times the jth component. And this is now our loss function that we want to minimize. We take the squared distance, and what I left out here in the beginning is we sum over all our samples. Okay, what do we have? We have the sum over all data points, and what this means is the distance between the xi and the xi first projected onto the specific coordinate and then expressed in this basis. So if you look at this expression here, this is exactly what you can do. So we have a 0.32, and if we take the 0.32, this would be our xi here, and project it onto the first unit vector, so this would be 3.2 times 1.0, you see that we get the 3 as this coefficient right here, and then we express it in terms of this basis. So this is really projecting onto the basis vector, which would give me 3.2 times 1.0 gives me the 3, and then we express it in terms of this basis vector. This is what we've written here. And so what you can see is that this is, give me the r leading basis vectors, so that if I restrict, express my data point only in these r basis vectors, it should be as close as possible to the true data. One thing that we are going to add to make this a little bit more useful, let's say, we are not picking any vectors, but what we are going to do is that ui transpose uj, so the inner product between two of these vectors is what we call the Kronecker delta, right? Which is 1 if I is equal to j, and 0 if I is not equal to j, okay? So what this means is they have unit length, right? Ui times ui gives me a 1, and they are orthogonal to one another. Ui times uj gives me a 0. And you see this here, if I did e1 times e2, this would give me a 0, so e1 transpose times e2, and if I take E1 transpose times E1, this gives me unit. So this is an orthonormal basis, right? It's orthogonal and unit length. And this is what we can demand here too. And so now you see, we have formalized this as a problem, and it looks challenging, but we are in luck. And this is something we're going to cover in the next video. There's this famous Eckhart-Young theorem, that tells us the solution is given by the r leading singular vectors of our data matrix, right? So this is the relation to the singular value decomposition. So let's write this down, and then we are going to discuss in the next video how to actually compute it. So the solution is given by the r leading singular vectors of x. Okay, so this is the main statement now, and we're going to see in the next video how to actually compute it. But what it means is, if I have my data matrix x, and I can perform the singular value decomposition, which we are going to see what it really means, we get a matrix U, such a basis matrix, and taking the first R columns of this gives me the basis that really solves this optimization problem, meaning I have the smallest projection error. Thank you and see you in the next video.